So this is way more people than I was planning for, and way less prepared than I was intending to be. But basically, Nina and I were talking about sort of understanding event loops, and I was saying that it's something that I kind of wrap my head around very late in life, even though it's a pretty fundamental part of applications, regardless of whether you were building like front ends or web servers or any sort of thing, right? So let's before we get into event loops, let's start with file descriptors, right? What is a file descriptor? So starting with just files, right? Like Unix command, Unix APIs for Unix slash POSIX APIs for opening, closing, blah blah, whatever, dealing with files, you get a file descriptor. You say open, you get an integer, which is kind of an index into some kernel data structure where the kernel is doing bookkeeping for you for this is the file you have open, right? It did some lookup, mapped it to some file system things. It has a pointer to where you are and all sorts of things like that. So that's what a file descriptor started out as. That's why it's a file descriptor. But I mean, you can think of a file as just a stream of data, right? And you do read, write, etc. on it. And now, if we extend that to say network communication, it's the same principle, right? It's a stream of data, read or write. So you use FDs for sockets as well, right? So the socket Unix slash POSIX socket API also gives you an FD, right? And you have now, in addition to a stream of data, you can also have events on this thing, right? So you may have a socket where you're saying, I want to wait till I have something coming in. So you'll say, wait until there is data to read, for example, and then I want to read. So now this file descriptor is now providing you a mechanism for stream of data as well as stream of events, right? And then in classic Unix philosophy, we basically extend this to everything, right? Devices are files, which means you can open a device, get an FD, and then be notified when things happen, including say, somebody press a key or somebody move the mouse, click the mouse, whatever. Right? I'm simplifying a bit over here, but the principle is the same across all of these things. And new kinds of things that you want to interact with can also then use the same mechanism, which is an FD. Right? So any questions around this? What is a file descriptor? What can it do? Why do we have it? Yes.
What is the difference between Unix and POSIX file descriptors?
Right. So Unix is this very weird poorly defined idea because there's so many different kinds of
You may
Unix.
want to repeat my question.
All right, so what is the difference between Unix and POSIX with regards to file descriptors? There isn't really a difference per se. Unix is just, it could have been any one of the many Unixes that existed over time. And because there were so many of them and each of their implementations might have been slightly different, there was POSIX, which is a standard for what is the expectation of the of from an API. So POSIX basically defines the standard, right? But in principle, it's the same thing when we're talking about this thing. Right. Anything else? No? Okay, cool. Right. So that's file descriptors. Now let's talk about being asynchronous, right? Now a program might want to be asynchronous for multiple reasons. The simplest one is that you may have only one processor, but you might want to be able to do things in separate threads for one. You might be waiting for one of many different things to happen, and you can't really be like busy wait on this thing and then busy wait on this thing and then busy wait on this thing. Any one of these things could happen. Let's take an example. Say you're writing a graphical user interface, right? What are the things that can, let's actually take a specific kind of graphical user interface. Let's take a browser. Okay, a browser can take input, right, in the form of keyboard, in the form of mouse events, right? Any other sort of input. So there's different types of inputs. A browser might be talking to the network, right? So you make a you say enter a URL and be like, look this up. It goes and talks to the network, makes a connection, maybe expects some data. And it's not, obviously it's not blocked during that time. You can still enter things, you can stop things, you can do a whole bunch of things. So that's two different kinds of things. It can also talk to the file system, right? So you might be doing something that requires it to write something to cache, read some settings, all sorts of things like this. And all of these things can be interleaved, right? I may have user input. I may have made a connection to a website. I may be accessing the disk to look up, say, a certificate. All of these things can be happening in parallel, right? And so imagine you're writing this program. How do you go about writing it, right? Like you basically just imagine you're just putting everything in main. Your main can't look like wait for something from keyboard, right? Or look wait for response from network, or like wait for disk read to complete, right? Can't really write that in a loop, right? Because you'd just be in a busy loop. So either you'd have to make a blocking call saying wait for something on key for on input, and then let me know when that's happened, which means I can't listen to network or file system in the meantime, or I just keep looping over this bit where I don't wait, and that's also very inefficient, right? So we want to do all of this asynchronously instead. So we can say, I want to know if I have any input on any of these devices, or I have any data that came in over the network, which I'm hoping to get that done, and I want to read this thing from a file and let me know when it's done, right? And that's where the idea of an event loop comes in. Right? The same thing applies to a server as well. Like if you may have a server that's waiting for a request, right? So waiting for something to connect to it. When it connects to it, it might need to talk to a database, talk to Redis, talk to some other net service on the network, talk to the file system, whatever it is. And each of these things again you might want to have them occur asynchronously, right? So same principle applies over there as well. So that's the motivation for doing these things asynchronously, and the canonical way to do that is event loops.
So, if you have blocking reads, then you're doing not doing a busy looping, right?
Right. If you have a blocking read, you don't, but then you're blocked. Right? If you have a lot of data to read during a blocking read, you basically affect responsiveness for example, keyboard input.
No, I mean in total you're gonna take same amount of time anyway, whether you do it blocking or
No,
non-blocking.
but so you may not take the same amount of time. So the question is responsiveness, right? So I type A, and I want that A to turn up on screen while a read is happening, right? If I block on a read before I accept the input and act on it, then the interactivity of your application is like lower, right? Yeah. So to handle things like this, we want an event loop. Right? What is an event loop? Effectively, and as a gross simplification, it's a way to say, here are a bunch of file descriptors. Let me know when something happens on any one of them. Sleep until that point. That's pretty much what an event loop is, right?
What do you mean by sleep until that point?
Right. Okay. So let me get back to file descriptors now. So I said you have read, write, etc. And I said you can get events on file descriptors. How do you get events on file descriptors? Right. The classic Unix slash POSIX API for that is called poll, right? And it's actually the one of the most terribly named APIs in the world because it does not poll. Okay. You'd use poll, give it a bunch of file descriptors, and it goes to sleep, right? And the file descript and basically the kernel's job at that point is to let you know when what you're waiting for on that file descriptor has happened, right? So you can say wait for read, or wait wake me up when if there's a read or an error, wake me up when there's space to write. For example, if you've got a network buffer and you filled it up, you want to say hey, let me know when I'm able to write to it, right? So that's what poll does. The poll API is basically give it a bunch of FDs, and when you call it, your application blocks. Right? The kernel knows that, hey, okay, this thing is waiting on these FDs. I can schedule the other things in. And when something happens, it goes back into the run queue effectively in your scheduler. And the kernel knows, okay, something has happened. I need to wake it up. Right? And of course, the poll is one thing. This poll, this select, and then there are newer areas such as epoll. And all of these are, in principle, the same thing. Right? The reason you use one over the other is because as we've increased the number of events and FDs and all of that we want to listen to, some of these APIs have give you the ability to be more efficient, right? So, for example, I don't have specifics, but you could imagine it as something like I have 10,000 file descriptors that I'm waiting on, right? When I get woken up, how much time does it take for me to figure out which file descriptor I'm actually being woken up for and why, right? So
Who
things.
figures that out?
It's part of the API, right? When you get woken up, you will get something filled in saying these are the FDs that are.
So the library that you use figures it out.
Yeah, so this the C library basically, right? And that's being populated by the kernel. So yeah, so that's how so that's basically what you do. So An event loop is basically kind of a user-friendly wrapper over pole, okay, or pole or its variants. And so typically the flow of an event loop is you have kind of a prepare step where you kind of say these are the things that I the sources of my of events possibly which are the ones that I want to wait on. Then you have a sort of pole stage, so prepare, then pole, which is basically saying here are the FTs, pole, let me know when something wakes up, wants me to wake up, you get woken up. And then you have a dispatch phase where typically now in, let's go back to the browser example, you've probably got a callback of some sort associated with each FT, right? So say after your file has been read, you want to be notified via some callback saying, hey, file read is complete. I mean, you have probably have a different callback for input handling. So a button got pressed, call this callback, and maybe you have some convenience around it saying, this is the button that got pressed, right? Similarly for a network, once the page is read, maybe you have you register a callback saying, do this, render this, blah, blah, so on and so forth. So those are the three stages. Prepare, which basically does some bookkeeping to know these are the FTs I need to listen on. Poll, which basically does the sleep. And dispatch, which then takes the things that you got activated on, that you got woken up for, and actually do that thing. And you just do this on a loop, right? And that is the loop part of the event loop. And that's really all an event loop is, right? Now, let's see, what else? So typically, the event loop will give you mechanisms to say, it will basically abstract these things out to various levels, right? So one way might be it gives you a convenience saying, hey, here's an FT, and start listening on this, and this is a corresponding callback, right? There's usually the idea of being able to register a callback for each iteration of the loop, right? You might want to do something, say, once per iteration. It might be called a defer event or an idle callback or something. But basically, the idea is that you just want to be like, run this thing within the event loop. And you may want to run multiple times. You might just want to run it once. But there are usually mechanisms to do this.
That's like having a null FT sort of thing.
Right.
A fake FT.
Exactly. Right. So usually, like, instead of faking it, you just have a mechanism that just says that effectively collects a list of callbacks to be called at the end of dispatch. Always.
Like hooks.
Yeah, exactly. Right. And often you want to do this because an event loop is usually running in some thread, and you may have another thread that is doing things, and you want to say dispatch something within this thread. Right. So on Android, for example, you have this UI thread, right? Which is where all the
You have on any UI.
Of course. Right. But yeah, so you have an event basically the thread in which the UI rendering and event processing is happening. And there are some things where you might want to dispatch a function within that thread. Like there's, depending on the data that you share between the two, some functions are only safe to be called within the UI thread, right? So you might want to say, just schedule this on the UI thread. So that this kind of mechanism is useful in that case. Right? And the other kind of convenience you might have is if you have sort of a custom source that is not backed by an FT, right? Maybe you have something. I actually missed one. Timers, right? You may want to say call this function every 300 milliseconds, right? Those are usually also backed by an FT, right? Because the kernel gives you a way to create a timer, which will give you an FT, and that FT will get an event when the timer elapses, right? So that's also, so basically everything in FT. If you have some magical thing that is not controlled by an FT, these event loop or main loop implementations give you some way to provide a custom source, which has basically some way to basically implement a poll, whatever that mechanism is, right? And to dispatch. Yeah.
So when you have a UI thread and like another thread, you effectively have two event loops. Is there some kind of a?
It very much depends, right? So for example, I'll give an example of, say, a music player, right? A GTK music player. So Rhythmbox, for example, will have one thread which is in charge of the UI and all of that. And we have one more, and that's running an event loop, a glib main loop. And you may have one more thread which is running a thread to communicate with the audio server on your desktop, right? So you might have two event loops. You may have a third one which is just might just be sleeping and waking up periodically. So it's entirely up to you how, like, what you're doing in each of those threads and how you want to structure
it. My actual question was, is there a standard for interaction between event loops? Like,
how
schedule
do
one thing and another.
Right. Okay. So, usually, like with any other data structure, you'd probably have mutexes and condition variables. That's how I usually have found this to work. Yeah. Right. So you may even have like you can have asynchronous message queues, right? If you want to send messages back and forth, right? So the event loop does not factor into your decision making very much necessarily, right? If you just want to send data back and forth in between, you can use any sort of thread synchronization. There is there are cases where you actually want to do mutual exclusion with the event loop, right? So in the case of Pulsario at least, right, you have common data structures. So your connection to the server, the main loop is kind of interacting with the server and doing like a write callback. So every time you want to play data, you get a callback in this event loop thread where you just keep writing data. And you usually do this so that the audio thread is kind of separate and never gets blocked, regardless of what you do in the rest of your application. But in the rest of your application, you might, for example, want to tear down the stream, make a new stream, things like that. And usually you want to have that be exclusive with the main loop thread. And we actually have, like, the main loop itself provides a mutex. And a mutex and a condition variable to allow you to say, get a lock on the main loop so that basically before the next iteration, on every iteration that the main loop takes a lock, right? And releases it during the sleep period maybe. But basically for every iteration, you have a lock in the event loop and you can take that lock in another thread to say, okay, block that thread for now. Let me do my thing. And then I'll unlock and let it continue. And you can also have like a wait and signal kind of mechanism using condition variables. Right, that's pretty much all I had.
So it looks similar. In Go, you have these things called channels,
right.
And you can write a select, scope block over multiple channels, and you can get notified when any of those have an event coming in.
That's the
right.
So that literally sounds like select
right.
Call.
But channels are in memory. Are they also backed by FDs, or how does it?
They can be. So for example, you can communicate between two threads using an FD. Right, you can basically make a pair of FTs, and so for example, often what happens is you create a pair of FTs, and then you fork a process, and the parent has one FT, the child has one FT, and they can communicate with each other across that FT, right?
No,
so it's basically a pipe.
Sure. What I meant was that is there a way to adapt, like put a adapter over a blocking queue to make it like an FT or.
Yeah, so you actually have this idea of an FD sem, a semaphore for which you have an FD, right? So you can basically sleep and wake up on an FD. That,
so you use all for semaphore.
Exactly.
What about performance of these things? What are places, like broadly, how would you describe performances of event loops?
Okay, performance.
What are the things that will make it slow? What are things that you can do to make ensure that it's fast?
Performance of event loops. Okay, so usually the overhead of performance that most people have found, like have worked to solve is how quickly the part I was telling you about, which is given the set of FTs and you've woken up, how do you say? How do you go as quickly as possible to the actual FD that woke you up and dispatched that event, right? And that's why this ePoll API came after Poll quite, when I say recently, in the last 5+ years or whatever. But that's a relatively recent thing. And things like libuv basically abstract out all of those details. The idea is that it tries to give you the most efficient implementation for your system. So if you have ePoll on your system, it'll use ePoll. If it doesn't, maybe it'll use Poll, and maybe there are efficient mechanisms on other platforms. So kind of giving a platform independent, efficient abstraction, that's usually where the performance consideration is. The rest of it is basically making sure that you don't block for too long so that the thread can keep running. If any of your callbacks is heavy, right, you're basically...
CPU intensive.
Yeah, well, see, yeah, exactly. CPU intensive, or you do something blocking in the callback.
Yeah.
Right? So that can end up slowing down your overall sort of loop iteration. And, I mean, of course, there's things like locks and stuff as well, which will... if you have a lot of lock contention, for example, what I was talking about before, with you have this event loop and then you have another thread and you have another thread maybe kind of doing mutual exclusion with this. That's sort of it doesn't matter whether you're using an event loop or not. That's just normal thread performance things. But in the context of event loops, the biggest thing is usually the performance of your poll implementation.
Okay. Also, event loops are generally used for IO bound stuff. So
yeah.
If you do CPU intensive things in event loop thread itself, that will basically block everything else.
You'll see a warning for this in on Android, right? Like if any of your callbacks run for too long, you'll actually see your log warning saying you've been blocking for too long. So for example, the render part of the thread needs to happen deterministically every 16 milliseconds, right? So that you have a 60 FPS refresh rate. So if you do anything to block that, you will actually get warned that this is a problem.
Generally, you'll offload CPU intensive tasks with different threads.
Yeah.
Right. So does the kernel also do have an event loop? Because I think of the FDs as also interrupts.
They are exactly that. So it's kind, or you can at least think of it like that. They're basically a software interrupt versus something coming in from user input would be a hardware interrupt. Right, but
Is it the case that there is an event loop that's converting your hardware interrupt into a software interrupt or a software FD?
Yeah, so effectively the kernel is abstracting out giving you a standard interface for events, whether those events are coming from within software or coming from hardware.
Okay.
Right, that's what it's doing. And the kernel itself runs threads. I guess in some sense it's also event driven in the sense that like the kernel only operates when either a process basically yields or uses its services or there's an interrupt coming in from the outside world.
Right.
Do you want to also talk about how this relates to green threads?
If you have something in particular in mind, why don't you come over? I can imagine green threads are similar, right? But instead of kernel being a scheduler, your runtime is your scheduler, right? That's really the only difference. But other than that, I guess the principle is the same.
As in, like, you don't write your code in terms of handlers and such.
Right.
The runtime converts your sequential code into handlers automatically.
Right. Okay. So basically, wherever it causes you to yield, wherever the green thread yields implicitly, it comes back over there by virtue of effectively the rest being a callback. Yeah. Okay.
So in that, it seems like green threads won't behave in the same way the way you write code with green threads is quite different from just event loops, right? In event loops, you want to be as responsive as possible, do as little as possible generally. Because you know that you're going to be switching as soon as you have no more.
Same thing applies to green threads.
But with green threads, the benefit you have is that there is an additional scheduler involved, which is scheduling and descheduling.
More importantly, there are implicit yields involved in whatever you're doing, right?
No, that's also with green threads, it's a M2N scheduling.
Right.
It's with event loop, it's M2N scheduling.
Right, but what I'm saying is that... The reason that green threads are basically one level of abstraction on top of the event loop and let you give you greater convenience is because you're implicitly yielding at points within your code.
Yes.
Right?
So there is an overhead to that.
I mean, basically, if you were to write your own M2N scheduling and break up your code, of course, there's an overhead, but then you have to actively think about how do I break my code up into all those chunks, which is the cost you want to be able to pay for.
So I have a question. When should we use event loops? I mean, as you mentioned in the beginning that you can of course write a code without event loops as well.
Right.
Right. And that's how it was or it is still, like threaded servers or pre-fork process servers and such, right? they don't do event loops.
I mean, in a sense, they are, right? They still, even if you kind of fork your process for each request, it's, I'm not sure how it would work without some sort of event loop as such.
Like, no, internally it will be an event loop,
yeah.
But your process will not be listening to different, like your server will not write any code for pulling multiple sockets and stuff. Just take a socket or open a process for it, give it the socket.
Right.
Like there wouldn't be the abstraction of a single event loop for the for your entire program.
Right.
But each thing will manage its own.
Right. So the question is of whether you should have one huge event loop and then handle everything in it.
The question is, what is the when should you use event loop and when should you use the multi-threaded model where each thread just does its stuff and sleeps when it needs to.
Each thread does its own loop, then, right? That's how you'd say
it. Not really a loop. It's basically a thread starts a work, finishes the work, dies. In between, if it needs to block for IO, it just sleeps, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a wasted computation, I understand. But it, the code is much simpler. You don't write pullers,
right.
You don't write handlers and such.
I honestly don't know the answer to this question, right? Like the consensus in servers seems to be that it's more efficient to have a single event loop to some extent at least, and then effectively scale out in processes. That's what Nina and I were just talking about. The consensus seems to be scaling out in processes, but still handling a large number of things in a single event loop is potentially more efficient than spawning of a thread per this thing. Even though Linux tasks are really efficient, like creating and destroying a thread is really cheap. Maybe it's still some overhead, especially as you tend to scale. But I don't think I have a clear answer to this question.
There is also those event loops which have a thread pool attached to it and what are called
thread pools.
Acceptor pools or something. I don't know.
So
worker pools.
It's basically, it's like thread pools, worker pools.
Yeah.
Whatever else you have, right? Like, but to me, this is kind of a... It goes very much to your workload, right? If your workload is the kind of thing where you can basically quickly dispatch and get back, then you can just use it in the event pool. But if you know that, hey, I'm going to have to do some work, then it makes sense to have some kind of thread pool and dispatch to that.
You want to give some examples
of
like libraries which implement event loops?
Right, so the things I'm familiar with, two things.
Libraries and applications.
Right, so I the two things I'm familiar with are glib and Pulsario, right? So glib has basically the idea of a main loop. It actually has the idea of, which I don't fully understand, but a lot, like you can have multiple contexts and you can have one loop iterating a context, so you can actually have different sets of sources and callbacks and separate them and iterate over them. But keeping that aside, so that I'm familiar with, both of them basically go through this exact same procedure. If you look at the code, it's literally prepare dispatch, prepare pull dispatch. And the Pulsario main loop, actually we have a main loop API, which you can have multiple main loop, you can have your own main loop implementation, right? So we have multiple main loop implementations that provide the same API. The APIs might be things like, it has a prepare dispatch run, right? It has a quit, so to stop this main loop, and it has base to add IO events, which is an FD, defer events, which is the idle callback, like the one thing per callback. I think that's about it. And then we have an implementation on basically like just it takes over the current thread and does all of this, or it forks a new thread and does all of this, or sits on top of the glib main loop, right? And just exposes the same functionality with it.
So Node is also
So Node as well as your browser is just one JavaScript event loop, and then all these async callbacks that you're doing. Pardon me?
Any UI.
Right. Not just UI, just like in this case, like the JavaScript language itself effectively is giving you an event loop and everything runs within that.
So is Twisted and such.
Right, Twisted. Yeah, so all of these things basically.
But there is a difference in the sense that there is a syntactic difference about how you you know, write the event loop in Node as
right.
or compared to how you write it in Twisted,
right.
compared to how you write it in Go or something.
Right. Right. So I guess in JavaScript it's basically implicit. Right? You start up, you've got an event loop, this is all you have, like you live with it. Whereas other languages might give you other thread primitives to work with, and that's coming into JavaScript as well in some form, like service workers and all of that. I mean, any sort of UI programming you do, you will see an event loop, right?
Or servers,
yeah.
in like when you're doing IO.
Yeah, yeah. So both of these things are more or less inevitable. Anything else? No?
Can you do, I think I asked this earlier, but I'm not very clear. Can you do, how are mutexes different from an event loop on a FT? Like waiting for a condition?
Like one condition versus many conditions.
So if you want to wait for many conditions and be woken up for any of them,
huh.
how is that different from doing a select on a bunch of FTs?
It is actually select on a bunch of FTs. So select and poll are effectively doing the same thing. Give a bunch of FTs. Let me know when one of them is.
I'm not talking about select and poll. I'm talking about select versus waiting for a condition on a bunch of mutexes.
How do you wait for a condition on a bunch of mutexes?
I don't know.
You use select or poll. Like you have to get an. Basically, the only way to do it, like if you have a bunch of FTs, like. Actually, I'm not sure if you can go from mutex to FD. Even though the underlying thing is probably an FD. At least for a pthread mutex, I don't think you can get an FD and listen to it, but I'm not sure about this. But effectively, what you're asking for is the poll mechanism.
So if I have this kind of thing where I want to wait for five different blocking queues.
Right. Yeah, you will probably have an FD semaphore. Right? Like each of these, you'll have an FD pair. Right, the writing end of the queue will have one FD. You will have one FD for reading FD for each of these, and you'll basically do a select / poll on all these five FDs, and whichever one enqueues something will also do a write on the right side, and the read side will get woken up saying, hey, there's some data ready. So this is how we actually implement FD-based semaphores in Pulse Audio. You literally get an FD pair, you write some dummy data from that side, you get woken up on this side.
So, I guess my question is that, is there no other thing you can poll other than FDs?
Mm-mm. So, the thing you poll is FDs. Like, if you look at the poll API,
poll kind of operation.
I'm not aware of anything. Like, it's powerful because there is only one abstraction to do this.
So, you're saying that poll is part of the FD abstraction?
Yeah. Cool. Are we done?